All right. In order to defuse the bomb, I'm going to need a paperclip, some cooking grease, a stick of gum, and a toilet paper roll. All right? Let's go. Unlike a lot of other important ideas in psychology, intelligence doesn't really have a definition. So I can't just give you a clear idea as to exactly what intelligence is. But we know that it does consist of a few important things. So we know intelligence is the ability to use knowledge and reason, to make decisions, learn from experience, solve problems, understand complex ideas, and adapt effectively to environmental challenges. Intelligence definitely isn't the same thing as just knowing lots of stuff. You know, if you know a lot of facts, if you know a lot of trivia, we could say that you are a wise person, but that wisdom is not the same kind of thing. Now, there are a lot of different theories that have become popular on the nature of intelligence. One of the earliest theories that still influences us today was proposed by Charles Spearman in 1904. Now, his whole idea was that we have a kind of general intelligence, a kind of general ability, or G factor. And all that means is if you're bright in one area, you're going to be bright in other areas. So you're either smart or not, to put it simply. But a lot of researchers didn't like this idea of there being a single kind of intelligence. So, a bit later on, Lewis Thurstone, in 1935, argued that instead of having a singular form of intelligence, we actually have seven. And this whole, you know, motivation to try to articulate there being multiple kinds of intelligence went on throughout the years. It wasn't until 1971 that we had another major theory. That's Raymond Cattell. So Raymond Cattell's theory is that we have two kinds. We have fluid intelligence and crystallized intelligence. So fluid intelligence is something that you can see mostly in younger people. So this is the ability to, you know, solve new kinds of problems, to process information, particularly new information, quickly. So this is why we say things like you can't teach an old dog new tricks, because if you remember back to when I was talking about, you know, developmental psychology, I talked about this fluid and crystallized intelligence, and what I said is that fluid intelligence is definitely going to be best when you're young, and it will actually decline as you get older. Now, the other kind of intelligence, the crystallized intelligence, that doesn't decline. That just gradually keeps building and building and building. And that kind of intelligence reflects your knowledge. It reflects the knowledge you've acquired throughout your life and your ability to apply it. But perhaps one of the most influential theories today is Howard Gardner's theory on multiple intelligence. So this was proposed in 1983, and Gardner's idea was that we actually have eight different kinds of intelligence. We have verbal linguistic intelligence, logical mathematical, visual spatial, body kinesthetic, musical, interpersonal, intrapersonal, and naturalistic. And he argued that all of these eight forms are equally important. So let me just tell you a little bit more about each one. So linguistic intelligence, that's just your ability to, you know, apply language and learn language effectively. Logical mathematical, that's your ability to think logically and deal with math problems effectively. Spatial, like visual spatial, that's like the artistic kind of intelligence, you know, the ability to understand the different aspects of a visual image and be able to reproduce that to a certain extent. And then you have body kinesthetic, that's just your ability to learn new physical kinds of tasks. Musical intelligence, it's it's pretty obvious, you know, your ability to understand concepts like pitch, rhythm, and, you know, just play musical instruments. Interpersonal intelligence, your ability to interact with other people, to effectively, you know, make an impression and understand what they're going through. And intrapersonal intelligence, that's your ability to understand yourself, understand your own emotions and your own kind of thoughts. And then finally, naturalistic. That's just your ability to understand the natural world. The last theory I would like to mention is Robert Sternberg's theory on multiple intelligence. Now, this was proposed in 1999, and his whole idea is that we have three different kinds. So, those three kinds go by different kinds of names, but we know them mostly as being book smart, so that means you're good in school, you're a good learner. Street smart, you have more practical kind of intelligence, you understand how to get around, how to interact with people. And then last one would be creativity. So book smart, street smart, and creativity would be the three kinds of intelligence according to Sternberg's theory. So one of the newest ideas in intelligence research is this idea of emotional intelligence. So emotional intelligence refers to your ability to apply knowledge about emotions to everyday life. And it consists of four basic components, which would be your awareness of your own emotions, your ability to manage your emotions, your ability to feel empathy for others, so understand the emotional state of others, and lastly, your ability to just handle relationships, you know, interact with other people. And nowadays, this idea of emotional intelligence is becoming so mainstream that it's argued that emotional intelligence is just as important, if not more important, than, you know, traditional intelligence. In fact, a lot of employers for big corporations, big businesses in this country, they give their new employees an emotional intelligence test before hiring them. The reason for that is, they want to find out, is this person going to be, you know, a normal person? Will this person be able to fit in, be able to be a good member of this business? Or is this person a psycho? Because obviously they don't want to hire a psychopath. And then finally, there's artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence is something that we talk about quite often. You know, I don't know how many sci-fi movies have the concept of artificial intelligence as the central idea. If you've gone to the movies recently, I'm sure you've probably seen something, some kind of philosophical discussion on the nature of artificial intelligence. Some extremely popular mainstream movies like Terminator or Matrix, these are all about the idea of creating a machine, creating a computer that can perform human-like problem solving and intelligent responding. And that's what artificial intelligence is. It's just a computer that thinks, a computer that deals with, you know, problems in the same way a human thinker would. But the thing is we have not yet developed anything like what you'll see in the movies. There's no such thing as artificial intelligence so far. The best we've done are very realistic computer simulations. If you've ever talked to your computer or asked your phone a question or something like that, and it gives you, you know, a good answer, well, that's just a computer simulation. It's not true AI. But something that should be pretty obvious is that these computer simulations are getting more sophisticated all the time. They're getting more developed all the time. So it just kind of makes you think, like, eventually we're going to get to the point where these computer simulations are so advanced and they're so good that how would we even be able to tell the difference between these super advanced simulations and true artificial intelligence? And here's a thought, if you can't tell the difference, is there a difference?